Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. My name is David Harris. I'm the Managing Director at the Charles Hamilton Houston Institute for Race and Justice, and I want to welcome you all here on behalf of Harvard Law School and Harvard University for what we think is a really important and overdue event. I'm not going to spend a lot of time today talking about it. I think we'll hear a lot about the context of why we're here over the next couple of days. We have a number of events, as you'll see in your program, that I think are very interesting and diverse and will benefit us all. So I'm not going to dilly-dally here. I'm going to turn this over to John Stauffer, who needs very little introduction from me. I just realized he's moving into the screen act field and he's doing a little bit of, I understand, different turn, but he is going to introduce our speaker today, and we're very fortunate to have both of them with us. So with no further ado, Professor John Stauffer.
Thank you, David, and thanks for helping make this possible. I'd also like to thank Amy. Is she here? She's really led the way for really getting this off the ground and making it happen. She contacted me in the fall and about the idea of a conference, and I said I love the idea, but I was already overcommitted for the year, and she really made it happen. And this is from someone who was working at the in Washington, D.C., not even affiliated with Harvard. I'd also like to thank Tom Horrocks. Where's Tom? Raise your hand. You'll see an exhibition that he curated and put on, Don Yacovone, who's right there, Mass Humanities, and Primary Source. We have a representative from Primary Source. And everyone else who helped make this conference happen. It's my great pleasure to welcome and introduce Jim Stewart, the James Wallace Professor of History Emeritus at McAllister College. He is, as most of you probably know, one of the preeminent scholars of abolitionism and of the complex relationships between social reform, race, and the political process. He's published a dozen books and over 50 articles on the problems of slavery and abolition in the United States, including Holy Warriors, which is the standard and best synthesis of American abolitionism, which was revised in 1997 and has been translated into numerous languages. I don't even know if Jim knows how many languages, but I say that as a way to convey that this has achieved truly world recognition. Abolitionist Politics and the Coming of the Civil War, which was a recent collection of essays. And Jim has published numerous biographies of abolitionists, including Joshua Giddings and the Tactics of Radical Reform in 1970, William Lloyd Garrison and the Challenge of Emancipation in 1992, To Heal the Scourge of Prejudice, The Life and Writings of Hosea Easton, 1999, Venture Smith and the Business of Slavery and Freedom, 2010, which is technically a collection of essays, but collectively functions, in my view, as a biography. And, of course, Wendell Phillips, Liberty's Hero, from 1986. Professor Stewart's book on Phillips is not only the most recent biography, but the most thorough and the most penetrating. Throughout his 40-some years in the academy, and he just told me he's technically been retired for the last, 10 or so, he's been a true friend and inspiration to anyone interested in social reform movements, especially in the 19th century. And I say that truly and sincerely. I mean, when I was a graduate student, he was indispensable to me. He was always willing to read an essay or a manuscript. He really treats the term colleague and collegiality in its original sense. He's not only a scholar of abolitionism, but an abolitionist himself. He founded Historians Against Slavery, which addresses human trafficking, and he's active in the abolitionist organization, notforsalecampaign.org, and recently many of his essays and his public addresses have connected 19th century abolitionism with the contemporary or modern movement to end human trafficking, what some people call modern slavery. Please join me in welcoming Professor Jim Stewart.
Okay, I'm going to turn on my mic, and you're going to tell me whether it works or not, okay? Usually they don't.
Does it?
Oh, good. Okay. John, that was a wonderful introduction, and I didn't recognize myself, but thank you anyway. It's really just both a delight and kind of a terror to be here, because the person that I'm going to try and introduce to you is a very, very challenging person to try to reanimate in the 21st century on the 200th anniversary of his birth. And so I'm a little daunted by the task in front of me. But before I go any further, I think that it's important to get the historical memory part of this title into play. And the way to do that is to be able to remember that in 1911, at the Park Street Church here in Cambridge, a guy by the name of Wendell Phillips Stafford, who happened to be the Chief Justice of the DC Supreme Court, his parents had named him after Wendell Phillips, convened a meeting of the NAACP to do the centenary celebration and recognition of Wendell Phillips. If Amy hadn't decided that she wanted to do it, no one would have remembered. I wouldn't have remembered. I've lived with this guy ever since I was 32 years old. I'm now 71. Completely passed over my head. It did not pass over the head of the NAACP, Crisis Magazine, W.E.B. Du Bois, and particularly in this case, Wendell Phillips Stafford, who said, we have reason, and the focusing of this meeting was on the Deep South and the problem of lynching and the terrible problem of the public torturing of black bodies all across the South during this time. And here's what he had to say. He said, we have reason to believe that the master spirits of the earlier crusade, Wendell Phillips' crusade, are with us now. In every charge we make against the forces of oppression, we have a right to feel that Garrison and Phillips are riding at our side. That's an incredible thing to say. We don't have that feeling. We live in a time where it takes a special effort on the part of one person to begin to invite us to the possibility of being able to reanimate a connection with the past that we've lost, because that's what I think we've done. And so today I'm going to try to do a certain kind of reanimation of Wendell Phillips. And in order to do that, let me just tell you one little other story. You know who James Weldon Johnson is. He wrote a thing called A Biography of an Ex-Colored Man, and my book ends with a quotation from him. I'm not going to tell you what that quotation says, because you can read it for yourself, but it has to do clearly with the fact that Wendell Phillips was living as a tremendous inspiration among young black people in James Weldon Johnson's graduating class in high school in 1910. The memory is there, the memory just ain't here. And so I'm going to try today to begin to convey a sense of what this person was like. And that's a terrible thing for me to have to try and do. I was thinking of other impossible tasks that I could be asked. And one that came to mind had to do with an exhibit that I saw at the Chicago Art Institute back in 1971. I had a friend who was a curator there. And the curator allowed us to come in the night before any of the crowd show up to see the entire first floor of the Chicago Art Institute populated with Renoir paintings. No crowds, no nobody, just my wife, me, a few other people being able to saunter around there. Or the other event that I can think of is listening to a Yo-Yo Ma concert. And then having to explain to people later on what it was. It really is impossible to capture that. And in some sense, Wendell Phillips is such an extraordinary amalgam of talent and commitment and intellect and presence that trying to, in a sense, reanimate him is sort of like talking about Yo-Yo Ma after the concert. And so that makes it very difficult in some ways to do this, but I'm going to try. Phillips, as you know, is all about Boston. And most of you are all about Boston, too. And so I think I'll start by a reflection that Phillips made on Boston. He said, Boston boys have a reason to be thankful for their birthright. the great memories, the noble deeds, the sacred places that town of poetry and history become the keenest ripeners of character. Keenest ripeners of character. History is supposed to do something to make you a better person. History is supposed to be something that allows you to take your environment, become deeply involved with it, begin to understand how you can deepen your own sense of what you're called to do by being involved inextricably with the past. The poetry of history, he calls it. Probably one of the most historically minded people I think I've ever met is Wendell Phillips, and someone with a deep, deep consistency in his life from the time of his first essays, the essays he had to write at the Boston Latin School when he was 12, all the way to the Scholar in the Republic speech that he made here finally in 1881 when he was invited back to keynote the 100th anniversary of Harvard's Phi Beta Kappa chapter. The ideas that are in the beginning and the end of his career are tied together by tremendous themes that reflect a lot of, what would you call it, spontaneity, change, revision, but there's a bedrock sense of the meeting in the of the past and the present with the person that's with Phillips his entire life. And I think it's that sense of knowing, it seems like such a cliche, where the past tense grounds you in the future, where you can think about many, many different things that go into making an explanation of how we got to where we are. Making it possible to make a confident leap about what one's personal responsibilities are, to take that past, reshape it as a set of memories that subsequent generations will hang on to as they continue the process of moving towards, in this case, a much better, much stronger, and much more equal United States of America. So how did Phillips get this way? He got this way because have you ever seen his house? How many people have seen his house?
I saw it in your book.
Okay, you haven't seen the big house. The big house sits on the crest of Beacon Street, right across from the big set of stairs that goes right down into the public garden, into the common. It is 4 freaking stories tall. It is the home office now of one of the largest insurance companies in the world. It has 17 bedrooms on the top floor, and each one has a fireplace, and each one is reserved for a servant. It was designed by Charles Bullfinch starting in 1802. It took him 3 years to design it and took another 3 years to build it. And it sits up there just bigger than you can believe. I've been in it. I wasn't allowed upstairs because the insurance company wouldn't let me. But you could see the banister coming down, circling from the second floor to the first, swooping down like this. And the newel post in the bottom is a big pineapple carved in wood. And you know what that is. That's Charles Bullfinch's signature. Wendell Phillips came from the most formidable family that you could ever possibly imagine coming from. And he knew it, and he loved the idea that that's where he was descended from. Well, who was he descended from? He was descended from somebody, the original Samuel Phillips, who lent John Winthrop money to get on the Arabella. And who immediately, when he got here, went to Watertown, founded a church, got into some doctrinal disputes with Winthrop, ended up being, as far as Wendell Phillips was concerned, a tremendous heroic connection that begins a story that he tells himself about how great and pioneering people open freedom for everybody else. He sees it in his family. Subsequent generations of Phillipses do certain things like the founding of Phillips Andover and Phillips Exeter Academy. They serve as mayors. They serve as there are 3 generations of them are on the Board of Governors of Harvard. They're just a spectacular family, is what they are. And Wendell's father, as you probably know, was the first mayor of incorporated Boston. He was the chair of the Constitutional Convention that put together the new Massachusetts Constitution of 1820. He was the youngest person ever to give the 4th of July oration on the Common. The people who preceded him were Harrison Gray Otis. And who was the other? Not Edmund Quincy. Josiah Quincy. This guy is the heir to three fortunes. One that he got from his family. His family were all involved in the China trade. His family was all involved in all kinds of trading. Who knows about slave trading, but it'd be interesting to find out. Second fortune comes from the woman that he marries, who's another big fortune, done the same way, Sarah Wally. And the third he makes by being the most spectacular and successful attorney in Boston during his time. That's how he gets to build the house. When Phillips is a little boy, he is accustomed to having these big people that I've just mentioned sitting in his living room talking to his dad while he listens. He's accustomed to the idea that he lives in this statement of privilege and power. Stand outside of it and look up and see how equal you feel to the Phillips family by the time you're done. This is all in his head, a great long story of tradition, service, distinction, success, which is conflated entirely with the idea of a past that expands liberty by being active, by being involved, by being engaged, and by being English. It's very important to be English in all of this because the roots of many of these values are things that he will finally locate in Cromwellian England, in the English Civil War. And when he starts talking about John Brown in the 1850s, he talks about him as an old Cromwell dug up from the past. You can begin to see how he talks about history in his own moment and referring it back to bigger structures of belief in past. Okay. So this is a very past-minded guy, but never with a sense of anachronism. Anachronism is what you see when you see people going out getting dressed up in revolutionary battle garb and reenacting the Battle of Lexington. Pretending to live in the past when you really can't live in the past, and a sort of a displacement of the real world in order to be able to live in a fantasy of militarism, heroism, all that. Phillips never had the idea of saying, gee, I wish I could have lived then. Rather, he has in his mind a sense of reception to the power of historical imagination to make him itch to the idea of getting involved constantly in reshaping now. Which means you work with the history creatively. You don't just receive it and then recopy it. So you can look at the beginning of Phillips's career, you can look at the end of Phillips's career. And I think Caleb McDaniel, who knows more about this right now than I do, because he's just been looking at Phillips's essays, which you can get. Where are they, at the Houghton? Oh, that's right. You can begin to see the old Phillips emerging in the young Phillips. So the sense of past and present is always there. And during the course of his lifetime, part of his idea was to spend as much time as he could possibly spend shaping what historical memory would become. I can give you lots of different examples. He worked real hard with some black guys here in Boston to try and create a memorial statue to Crispus Attucks. Spent a long, long time with a guy named William Nell, who's an amazing person in his own right, black educator, activist, lots of different things, trying to raise money for a statue for Crispus Attucks. When is he doing this? Right at the time that John Brown's raid is happening. Why is he doing that? Because he wants the world to remember something that he's going to put in place, much as he's remembering what his predecessors have put in place. He spends a lot of time late in his life trying to save the Old South Meeting House, which is a church, right? The reason he wants it saved is because he wants the animating spirit of the Puritans, which, by the way, is a religion that is a battle, not a dream. That's his talk. The animating spirit of the Puritans would be something that you can walk into by walking into the church and feeling yourself refreshed and empowered by the spirit that's been constructed there. The minute Daniel Webster died in 1851, and his body was dragged all over New England, and people were dressing up in crepe and black and sending off all these pans to this great statesman, who the year before had basically sold the next generation of enslaved people into further slavery, according to Phillips, and he was right about that. He spent an entire year doing nothing but taking every bit of rhetorical power that he had and putting it into a speech called Idols, I-D-O-L-S. And idols is a question of, what do you pray to? What do you hold up in public as an example of what's important to emulate, what's important to believe in? And the whole idea of this speech and other speeches that he made was to tear down the idol being constructed for Daniel Webster. At one point he says, you know, I can't quote Phillips ever. But he gives off the thought, he says, you know, if I can imagine Lucifer, now remember where Lucifer is down in the lowest circle of hell, freezing. If I can imagine Lucifer being pushed over in order to be able to make room for somebody, it would have to be Daniel Webster. Which brings us to this business that makes so much of what I want to talk about so difficult to talk about. This is the guy who, in the greatest age of oratory that the United States has ever experienced, was the greatest of those orators. Period. People who despised him said that to him all the time. You're crazy, you're a maniac. But God, can you talk? Richmond Inquirer, its very famous tagline that gets put to Phillips, calls him an infernal machine set to music. And an infernal machine back then is an improvised explosive device. People were just pioneering those things. And everybody came to understand that if you found yourself sitting in an audience, listening to Wendell Phillips, something very rare, something very challenging, something very inspiring, and something perhaps very terrifying was going to happen to you. And you went to his talks with that in mind. And he knew it. I mean, we're so far away from the kind of public role that he played that it's hard to imagine what that role was. Because today, pundits are people that you just see on CNN and people who toss off opinions of one kind or another. In the middle part of the 19th century, we didn't have that kind of media. The new media then was basically allowing human bodies and voices to travel by rail, so you could get from one place to the other quickly. Second new medium was steam-driven presses that could give you 20,000 copies in an hour of what somebody had written, had spoken. The third is stenographic reporting, which is stenographic reporting. You know, you can get all the words. And in a culture that was absolutely print-driven, Wendell Phillips had a double audience, the people that listened to him and the people who read him and the people who bought his speech afterwards and then gave it around to other people. And so, in some ways, Phillips, the word celebrity doesn't work. It's a role we don't have anymore. But it is sort of like having to explain a Yo-Yo Ma concert. People tried to do it. I went through in the book collecting reactions to Phillips' speeches. And the most interesting thing is the reaction to him himself before you ever hear him talk. Or people who just knew him outside of the forensic environment that he spent so much of his time with. Everybody who met Phillips, strangely enough, liked him. It's strange to say that for somebody as controversial as he is, but from the time he was at Harvard, where he was president of all of the social clubs, where he was the valedictorian for the senior class in 1831, where his classmates were so admiring of his physique that they took the measurements of what they knew to be Apollo Belvedere, big Greek statue that was rediscovered back in the 1820s, and then asked Phillips to pose in the same pose to see how closely they they approximated each other. This was a guy who got handsomer with age, who at the same time was just one of the most attractive and open people, according to what everybody says about him, that you could ever imagine. His roommate, a guy named John Tappan Pierce, said, though I had seen him before, I was drawn to him by an irresistible attraction. Phillips was just plain handsome. I don't know how many people that you've ever run into who just sort of take your breath away by standing there and looking good, but evidently he could do that. And he worked out in the gym every day, and he was well-muscled, and when he was 70, he was still riding horses. I'm 71, and come on. And another one, Edgar Buckingham, who was a classmate. Phillips was really handsome, a figure like the young Apollo, and which became the idea of making the comparison. Emerson. Phillips gives no idea of his perfect eloquence in casual intercourse, how easily he wears his power, quite free, disengaged, and in no way absorbed by a care or thought of the thunderbolt that he carries within. You know people who have this capacity to intimidate you by how smart they are? Or in one sense or another, as so many athletes do, take their athletic accomplishments and use them as things that give you social counters to make you feel superior. This is a guy who knew that he had something absolutely magical inside of him, and he never used it except when he was asked to, which is a kind of control, a kind of constraint. And here's another description from college. A plain, honest man who loves sincerity and truth and can tolerate no shows of false dignity. He opens his heart to you as the spring buds do theirs. He is totally transparent and entirely without guile. I can't comment on that, but you hear it over and over and over again, that this guy is too good to be true, but it's true. Okay, so I've been suggesting that it's the oratory that's really all involved in all this. And I think the key to understanding what his oratory is all about is the answer that he always gave to people who would ask him, "Geez, Mr. Phillips, how did you learn to give speeches like that?" And he would say in response, just this: think out your subject with care. Read all you can. Fill your mind. And he's serious about that. If you go in the Boston Public Library, you'll see big things called commonplace books, where he has collected stuff from all over Western culture. Some of it cut out of newspaper articles, some of it transcribed, thousands of different sources, where he's just collected an archive of stuff that he can look at, and he can think about, and he can fill his mind with. He's always doing research. So preparation is really important. Think out your subject with care, fill your mind. Prepare, control, know exactly what you want to say. But on the other hand, then forget that you are going to make a speech. Yeah. Or are making one. Be inspired with the idea that you are going to strike a blow. Carry out a purpose. Having forgotten yourself, think about this, having forgotten yourself, you will be likely to do your best. Do you get the sense of tremendous control and spontaneity that go into this guy? The precedents of history weigh on him all the time, but in a way that liberates him to feel that he can act. You know the circumstances of his marriage? Okay. I could go on forever, obviously, about all this stuff. His wife, Ann Terry Phillips, is another fortune that he marries, and she's an orphan. She gets the whole thing from the Green family, which is one of the big law trading families in Boston. So Wendell Phillips is immensely rich all of his life, except he manages to spend it all and die in poverty. And Ann Green is known from the time that she is taken into the Chapman household, which is another big aristocratic family here in Boston, as a ward of that family, that she's a very frail, very unhealthy young woman. And Phillips meets her, is smitten by her. At the same time, she falls into this tremendous medical crisis where doctors say she's going to die. And he is deeply in love with her. His other complicating feature is that he just graduated a couple years before from Harvard Law School, and his career supposedly is to become a lawyer, which he hates. He don't want to be a lawyer. He despises being a lawyer. He sits around in his law offices doing genealogies of his family and finding out more things about Samuel Phillips of Rowley and all that, and beginning to do research on a guy who becomes very important, the major figure in the Scholar in the Republic address, a guy by the name of Harry Vane, who was an English Puritan who came to the colonies and then went back to England to fight for Cromwell and ended up sacrificing his life. The point is that Wendell Phillips was at a spot in his career and with his sense of this historical mission that his family put on him, where he didn't know what to do with himself. And at the same time, this woman who he knew that he loved, he was never going to be able to do anything about that. And he was absolutely stifled. The Chapman family would not allow Wendell Phillips to visit her. Next thing that happens is Phillips shows up at the Chapman place and he says, I'm going to go up and propose to Anne Green. I'm going to ask her to marry me. Look at the impulsive gesture that's built into the middle of this. He's not going to allow any authority in the world to get in his way. No, you can't go up there. It'll kill her. Finally, he insists that he has to see her, that he's going to propose. And he did. And they got married. And in a bold moment of seizing the present in order to be able to create the future and to live up to the legacies of being empowered from the past, he's done this incredibly out-of-the-box thing. And incredibly out-of-the-box things are things that he afterwards, from then on, comes to believe very deeply are the most important transforming moments in history. John Brown's raid on Harper's Ferry, Toussaint Louverture's leading of the Haitian Revolution, Sam Adams's leading the American Revolution, Oliver Cromwell's overthrow of tyranny in England. There are all these signposts along the way in both his life and in a remembered past that are built on the idea of bold people who have become well prepared, forgetting themselves into immortality, which is a phrase from Phillips that he uses a lot. So when he's in this business of speaking to people, he's not giving a speech. In a sense, he's making his private life public. It's got a mask in it. He's not talking about himself in the first person singular, but it's all about the emotional and intellectual architecture that's made him the person that he is. And that, it seems to me, is what allows everybody else to say, gee, how spontaneous he is, how open he is, how much it seems he's telling us the truth. Because in some fundamental way, this is not a speech, it's a work of art. If you memorize it, if you declaim it, if you're Edward Everett, which is the competing rhetorical style of that period, you write out every sentence, you memorize the whole thing, and then you stand up and look bad at Gettysburg when Abraham Lincoln does something quite different. So anyway, my suggestion here is that the Phillips that we're talking about is really a serious forensic artist with a tremendous sense of history and a tremendous sense of the capacity of individuals to shape a better world for themselves and for others. He shaped a better world for himself when he married Anne Terry Green Phillips. The rest of that world is a world that you'd have to read the book about because she stays ill for the rest of her life. Best guess is that she had rheumatic fever, that she couldn't stand being in a lighted room. She had doctors with her all the time. They moved from the grandeur of the big Beacon Hill residences that they were used to living in to a small place on Essex Street that had a millinery on the first floor and rooms upstairs, room for one servant, room for them, room for nothing else. Simplest way to be able to escape aristocracy that you can possibly think of is to live. There weren't even any other houses there. It was all small retail businesses and Wendell and Anne's house. So the marriage is also, and the private correspondence between them is just spectacular. I won't even go into it. You just have to read the book to find out about why, for example, Wendell Phillips would send a clipping from a toenail of his through the mail from Vincennes, Indiana, to Anne back in Boston as a symbol of his affection. They addressed each other in diminutive names that nobody else knows the reason for. They had their own code language for talking to each other in terms that were a private joke between them that no one else ever shared. I could go on and on, obviously, and I don't want to go on for too much longer. But what I'm suggesting here is that in order to be able to stay married to Anne Terry Green Phillips, he had to be the most disciplined husband in the world. He'd go out and buy 2 pints of strawberries instead of one, and then get the similar sizes of the strawberries together so that they could all be presented to Anne because he knew that she liked them that way. He had to make sure that every morning an organ grinder would show up out in front of Essex Street to welcome Anne's welcoming of the day. She referred to the worst times that they had together as times that they were simply in the hospital together. He was her nurse. He spent an amazing amount of time simply massaging her, touching her, feeling her. Whatever all this has to do with sexuality, nobody can say. But what it has to do with a lot is a structured kind of devotion that makes a very constrained marriage by the problem of health into something that worked very successfully. By the time they've done, they've adopted an orphan who was the orphan of one of the previous house servants that worked in the Phillips household. And by the time they were done, they'd also adopted, for all intents and purposes, William Lloyd Garrison's son, Wendell Phillips Garrison. Sent him to Harvard, did a lot of other things. So what I'm trying to suggest is that in this framework of, as he always said, read all you can, fill your mind, be prepared, then forget what you're doing and be yourself. You can see Phillips doing this in all kinds of different areas of his life. Immediately he comes back from England after a big tour there where they try and find a cure for Anne that doesn't work. Next thing he begins to figure out is you got to make Boston look like you. If you're going to live here, the standards that we set for abolitionism in the United States are standards that have to be lived out in Boston, starting in 1840, which is the year he gets back. 1841, excuse me. He had a saying that went like this, we've abolished the slave, he's talking about Massachusetts, but the master remains. And what he's talking about is racism, white supremacy, segregated schools, inferior labor conditions, all kinds of different things. The minute he gets back home, the idea is to start the reconstruction of American society, not in Mississippi in 1866, but in Boston in 1840. Desegregating railroad. First thing he does, gets together with a bunch of people, black and white, goes to the state legislature and demands that they repeal their miscegenation laws that had criminalized sex relationships between dark-skinned people and light-skinned people. Finally, they did that. He was being thrown off of trains and buses until he started wearing all of his finest English aristocrat clothes. And he would always travel with a black guy to desegregate everything. So what I'm trying to suggest is this is somebody who begins to build layers of, what would you call it, symmetry. That's a good artistic word, symmetry. The idea that there is a doctrine of correspondences between what you remember, what you value in the past, what you see in yourself, the values that you hold for your future, and how you can reimagine the world that you're living in this minute to be different because you're there. Am I making sense? Am I being clear about all that? There's a lot of connections there that have to be made all at once. And so it's desegregation. It's building statues. It's giving speeches on Crispus Attucks in the middle of John Brown. He's got a whole speech on Toussaint de l'Ouverture that he gives over and over and over again throughout the antebellum period and begins giving constantly as you move towards 1859, 60, and 61. With the idea of creating new idols, back to the theme, what will people remember about this time that I can do to implant that memory? You know who got all the archive together for the Boston Public Library anti-slavery collections? Wendell Phillips. Every bit of it. His hope, as he was getting this together, is that he would be able to get Charlotte Fortin, who was a very important African-American figure of the Civil War period, to be appointed as curator of this collection. That's how they got Henry Wright's manuscripts, that's how they got a lot of the Garrison stuff, that's where all these big runs of the Liberator come from. Phillips was all over the place collecting this stuff. And at the same time, for reasons not known to much of anybody else, keeping his own stuff for himself. I started with Wendell Phillips in 1971 with the assumption that he had no central collection of private papers, that I'd have to scrounge all over the world to just pick up things. And then a dear friend who I have to remember here, his name is Irving Bartlett, and he's dead now, a great biographer of many important antebellum American figures who taught in the English department at Pitt, wrote me a letter. Remember the days when you used to receive letters that were written by people? Dear Jim, I understand you've undertaken a biography. He'd written the earlier biography of Wendell Phillips, a very good book, with a take from his time that's every bit as legitimate as the take I took from my time. And he said, I have just found in Tuxedo Park this huge trunk full of Wendell Phillips' papers. And I've gotten this enormous grant from the National Endowment for the Humanities to accession these documents at Houghton Library. This is where they are now, and this is where we're going to be going. He said, after I get them accessioned, I want to put out a small volume showing the world what some of these documents are. But after that, I want you to be the first person in to look at it. Phillips had developed this huge archive for himself that, for reasons that I don't understand, never turned into public property. But I think the main reason why is because it contains such tremendous correspondence between him and his wife that he didn't want other people to see, but that he couldn't bear to destroy. So anyway, this is a person who has tremendous historical mindedness in everything that he's doing. So when he's finally invited, when did I start this? About 10 after? 10 after, was that about right?
Yeah.
I've been going now for 35 minutes. You still with me? Okay. Okay, good. So, where was I? Now I'm all off key. Yeah. He comes back in 1881 to give this Phi Beta Kappa lecture. The last time he was on campus was when he was valedictorian of his class in 1831. It's been 50 years exactly. What topic does he pick? The scholar in the Republic. There's only one other Phi Beta Kappa address that anybody can think of immediately within the cultural capital of people living in Massachusetts that title would reverberate against, and that would be Ralph Waldo Emerson's American Scholar. And Emerson and Phillips knew each other very well, went back and forth with each other a lot. There are Emerson letters in the Crawford Blagden collection at the Houghton Library. And what you see is someone who says, all right, I haven't been here. I've been invited here since 1831. That's 50 years. I'm 71 years old. By the way, I am too. This is just weird. Just entirely weird. I don't intend to convey the impression that I'm a reincarnation. I just feel like I've suddenly been invaded by some sort of species that's taking me over. I don't know. So anyway, he's able to frame the scholar in the Republic against the American scholar, which is a very transcendental kind of statement about the role of the intellect in the Republic. Phillips is all about the idea, and this is his most famous quote, that the scholar should stand apart from any interest to open up a question and to riddle it with light. The idea being that the scholar's role was to expose, to explain, to demand explanations from others, to hold people accountable. It's all politics for him. That the scholar in the Republic is truly, and this is where I'm going to turn to something that is personal, about professing. There's evil in the world, and it's the constant job of agitators to expose that evil, to destroy the complacent veneer of democracy, to see the tyranny that lies underneath it. That the tyranny is a tyranny of inertia. It's a tyranny of not caring. It's a tyranny of living small. It's a tyranny of living by cliches. And so what the scholar is supposed to do is to tear all that apart and make people have to see what's really there. Because what you see is not what you get in American democracy. And Caleb makes the argument, which I didn't make in my book, but which I should have, and I'm grateful to all these people that are readdressing Phillips, by the way, in this conference, because they're doing wonderful things, that really, in a lot of ways, what Wendell Phillips is doing is a very creative response to Alexis de Tocqueville's Democracy in America. So at any rate, 1881, he makes this final statement. You never hear from him again. He stops writing for the North American Review. Who does he endorse? He endorses anarchism in Russia and in Eastern Europe. He's all about protecting Indians. He's all about the whole business of saying, yeah, we're a republic now that has a much expanded franchise than the one we had before, but what's going on in the Deep South now is terrifying. And so it's not an address that has to do with the high culture of transcendentalism, which by this time the war long ago had fractured, but instead a statement of an old man trying to relate back to his origins in such a way that he can leave a memory that will allow us to have this occasion. How did he sound when he talked this way? Thomas Wentworth Higginson knew him better than anybody else did from the standpoint of being able to write about him. Actually, Higginson wrote the first biography of Phillips, and of course was one of John Brown's financial backers. He said, the keynote to Phillips' oratory was its conversational quality raised to the highest power. No other orator began so entirely on the plane of his average hearer. It was as if he simply repeated in a slightly louder tone what he'd just been saying to a familiar friend at his elbow. Can you get a sense how relaxed and how informal it is and how you just sort of slide into this occasion? Nobody stands up and says, this is a serious moment. I'm really pissed. I want to tell you some stuff. Instead, there's this invitation to become, with hundreds of people involved in what basically feels like a private conversation between you and him, where all the conversation coming from your side is silent in response to what he's saying. People tried to figure out how to express their reactions to Phillips's speeches in various metaphors. One cultural critic from the Ohio State Journal decided that Phillips' speeches were like finely wrought chain mail that a knight would wear, where the logic of his words and ideas was so tightly woven that no opposing instrument could penetrate them. That you would listen, continue to listen, I'm paraphrasing the Ohio State Journal now, and he would surprise you into enthusiasm. Woo, hard to think of, isn't it? here's another. No waste of power, no bursts of eloquence, everything is subdued, strong, telling. He steals upon the audience and surprises them into enthusiasm. This is the thing I was remembering before I had it now. He had exactly the manner of an agitator, but it was entirely without agitation. A person who could say the most threatening and scary things about how the world ought to work and why the world wasn't working, and at the same time, never put you in a position of feeling defensive. How does this work? Yeah. His words are like oil on troubled billows of chafed sea. How's that for a metaphor? He rebukes the winds of strife and the waves of faction. An agitator does this. The severe visage of the tyrant or the turncoat present begins to relax. He is the mobber of mobs. Final one. I love this one best of all. A Wendell Phillips speech is like a beautiful damsel in déshabillé. His quotations then are ringlets of her hair. Now, this guy really goes a few yards to do this. And the main part of his lecture is like a loose gown, which now and then reveals a neck of pearl and a voluptuous bust of snowy whiteness of beautiful proportions. Other people said that he was like a snow-capped volcano, that nobody understood the power and the depth of the fire within until he opened his mouth, and all of a sudden, fire that doesn't burn, I'm paraphrasing another one, comes out to people. So that's what it felt like to be Wendell Phillips's audience. By the time it was done, people were able to actually grant that without ever holding office, without before the Civil War ever voting, never cast a ballot because he felt that the Constitution was a pro-slavery document, never wanted a conventional career in politics because a conventional career in politics would be compromise and the addition to the problem of the tyranny of the majority rather than an exposure of it. By the end of his life, especially the apex of his career during Reconstruction, this guy is one of the most powerful political actors in the United States, doing exactly what he thought for his time Oliver Cromwell had done for his time, John Brown had done for his time, Toussaint de l'Ouverture had done for his time, but with the idea that instead, and this is the big difference, instead of creating bloodshed and upset, that the proper role of the scholar in the Republic was to create a new understanding of a broader democracy in which the participation of ordinary people would become so great that there would be no need for violence, for bloodshed, for upset. that in Phillips's mind, the whole final role of an agitator is not to overthrow the world by the sword, but instead to educate the world into something better. You agree with that, Caleb? Okay, I'm really worried about Caleb, because he's you can tell I'm keying off in the lobby, because he's been thinking about Phillips a lot more than I have. So anyway, I haven't talked to you at all about how he felt about the Constitution very much. I haven't talked to you at all about how he was involved with women's rights, Indians, what his theories about democracy were. That's all for next time. That's all for tomorrow. These are great papers. My job, I thought, was to simply try to give you a sense of the impossible, which is to try and reinvoke this man in some way so that you can begin to understand why someone would name their kid after Wendell Phillips and then have that kid decide to go to the Park Street Church for the NAACP to remember him 100 years ago. I'm glad we're doing it now. The question that remains for me, though, is simply this, getting back to what Wendell Phillips Stafford had to say. In every charge we make against the forces of oppression, we have a right to feel that Garrison and Phillips are riding at our side. We don't feel that way. And if we did, we'd be doing a lot of things that we're not doing now. And I'll simply close by pointing out that there are three times as many enslaved people in the world today as there were in the Western Hemisphere. That means Brazil, Cuba, the United States, lots of other places, when Abraham Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation. Slavery is a monster problem. And there is no anti-slavery movement. And I'm not trying to do something stupid like say, what would Wendell Phillips think of that? You can't answer that question. What you can ask is, what do you think of yourself knowing about Wendell Phillips? And it seems to me, and this is just a personal statement, I spent about 40 years basically triggered by the civil rights movement to answer a basic question: how did it get this way that there was so much hurt, so much torment, and so much exploitation around differences in skin color? That was a question I started having to ask in the early 60s. Drove me into history, made me become a historian. Because the wonderful thing that history can do that nothing else can do, and I think Wendell Phillips and I are alike in this sense, it can tell you how it got this way. It doesn't just ask, what is it and what can we do about it? You have to ask the question, what makes it come into the world this way, and how do you go back to try and figure out from what you learn about that to change it? So when finally it occurred to me that, and John Stauffer has been an absolutely central part of a giant construction of a whole new way of explaining the narrative of American history around the contentious questions of skin color difference and common humanity. And over the past 25 years or 30 years or so, there's been a whole bunch of scholars, many different generations, starting with old people like C. Van Woodward and on into much younger people that are sitting here in this audience, that have been attacking that question over and over again. And I've been part of that, and I've been proud to be part of that. And I think we've done a tremendous job of resurrecting a narrative that otherwise would have, by the tyranny of the majority, been silenced. But at least for me personally, I can't look back at 40 years of doing all that and then look at this question of modern slavery in the eye and say, well, that's too bad. So I'm closing with an invitation that you pick up a pamphlet for a group that I have gotten myself involved with, and in fact, it sprung into my head one day, Historians Against Slavery, which is a way to be able to try to create a whole new understanding about the experience of enslavement and struggles against it within the United States in such a way that we can begin to see this new problem of modern slavery, which is very different in many respects from the slavery that we have in our historical memories, by comparing it to the slavery that we have in our historical memories. We can see it if we can see the differences between the one today and the one before, but at the same time underneath that, there are tremendous similarities. And we can also begin to understand that the United States has always had slavery. A lot of it did go away in 1865. The world post-1865 for dark-skinned people is a totally new planet from the world before that. But at the same time, you can begin to read scholarship about the southern prison systems. You can begin to read scholarship about convict lease systems and debt peonage. And then you can read about the modern incarceration rates that are going on in today's privatized prisons. You know that there's slavery. Yep. And you know that there's slavery when you live in a state like Minnesota, which has very white, very progressive, despite Michelle Bachmann, way of going about social change, which per capita in the United States ranks third for incidences of documented enslavement of people. Why? Because of Indian reservations and because of the Mall of America, which is a sexual tourist haven. The Mall of America, the largest indoor shopping mall in the world. How did it get this way? Those are all historical questions. The question of trafficking of Indian women in Minneapolis, St. Paul, or across the Great Lakes on the big ore boats, is a question of understanding what happened to Native Americans in Minnesota, isn't it? And in other places in the world. So Historians Against Slavery is a way to try and take what we know about American slavery and struggles against it, hitch it directly to the problem of slavery in the world today, reanimate with all kinds of new applications the strength and vitality and wisdom of the African American story, so that continuing claims for justice out of that community and many others can be mobilized together with claims for justice by many other groups of people in the United States and elsewhere. So I think that one of the things that we can conclude here is not that Wendell Phillips would like this or not like this, but what we can ask ourselves is the same kind of questions that he was asking. What does the past tell us about who we are? What power does it give us to reshape a sense of life's possibilities and to imagine a connection between past and present that allows us to glimpse a better future, which is within our reach to shape? Thank you.